Good. Hello and good morning, everybody. Welcome to Discovery Church and tuning in. Thank you for tuning in to Facebook Live. And for those of you who will be watching this sometime in the future on YouTube, thank you for tuning in there. Thank you to all of our folks who are here, our 9 people, 10 including me. We are still legal. I know a lot of you have questions about the governor's announcement of the 50% capacity, and you're wanting to know if we can return to things as usual this coming Sunday. I don't know yet. Hopefully have some more information tomorrow to better clarify that. So just be patient, and as soon as we have some clear answers, we'll be sure to let you know what those answers are. And before I forget, happy Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers. And you know what? You either are a mother or you have one. Whether she's with you or not, whether she's gone on to be with the Lord, it's a day to celebrate your mom. And as we're going to get to in weeks to come, one of the great commandments is to honor your mother and father, that your days on this earth might be long. Not long as in drudgery, but we'll get to that a little bit later on. But nonetheless, happy Mother's Day. Let's begin with prayer today, shall we? Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for blessing us with life. Thank you for our mothers. We want to celebrate them today and to ask you to bless them in a special, special way. For those who have gone home to be with the Lord already, God, thank you that they are home, permanent home. They're completely healed. They have no aches or pains. No sufferings, no trials or tribulations of any kind. I pray that for those who have lost their mothers, that they will be comforted with that truth, knowing that your word says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. And for those who know Jesus as Savior, that's where they are. We thank you, Lord, for that blessed hope and truth and promise that comes from your word. And again, bless our moms today in a special way. As we have gathered together in your church this morning, and some of us are in the building, but the church itself is not the building. It is the people. We've gathered together, some of us practicing social distancing, of course, but we're still your church. We ask for you, God, to reach into our homes and into our hearts, our minds, our lives, and touch us with the moving of your spirit today. And we know that you are all places at all times. And so we acknowledge that truth, and we just surrender ourselves to you today, God. And we ask for you to bless us and cause us to worship you in spirit and in truth. It's in Jesus' name that we do pray. And everyone said together, amen. Our praise team is going to come right now. We have James and Vicki Addison with us again today. I know many of you love their music and you're happy that they're here. And we are as well. Austin, of course, is here. He actually was the first one here this morning. Maybe Francis might have been here before. But he actually beat us today for the first time. And of course, my wife is here, not to forget her, it's Mother's Day. But they're going to lead us off today with Power in the Blood. Let's worship together.
Good morning. Let's worship in song. Thank you. together as we sing about that wonderful, merciful Savior. He is so good to us.
Peace of God, cover me.
Amen. I can just picture some of you in your homes right now hearing that song. And maybe you're like me and you tear up as you hear some of those words. Cover me when I am hurting. Cover me when I am not strong. Cover me when I am going through the storm. I'm convinced that as life trudges on day after day, a variety of us are hurting for many reasons. A variety of us are going through a storm of some sort, and we need the peace of God to come and cover us, to wash over us, to envelop us with the peace of God, the peace that cannot be explained. Yet, when that peace does come, I understand that God is with me. He's with us. He's with you. He loves us. He cares about us. God, reach into every home, every heart, every mind, every soul right now who's listening or who will listen at some point in the future, and cover them with your peace. May they know you in the fullness of your love, how much it is that you love us, that you would send your only begotten Son into this world to pay for our sin, to cover our sin with his blood and save us for all eternity. God, thank you for the covering of the blood of Jesus that rescues us and grants us eternal life. Lord God, the words thank you are not enough. And so cover us. Give us your peace. We thank you, Lord. We praise you in this moment. It's in Jesus' name that we do so. Amen. Amen. Thank you so much. That's a beautiful song. Amen. Saw you tearing up too. Well, do you idolize? I know this is not necessarily a message fitting for the time in which we're in some ways, but maybe in other ways it is. I know a lot of pastors and a lot of churches are talking about the 10 plagues of Egypt because of the plague, this pandemic, and so on and so forth. And you know what? Before I go any further, I have not forgotten the offering. I just put the slides in earlier, and so I had to skip over them when we started our worship. If you would like to give to the Lord through Discovery Church, we treasure your gifts. And that's what we consider them to be, gifts. Gifts to the Lord. And you can give to us in a variety of ways. You can give to the Lord through us in a variety of ways. You can write a check and mail it to us. Our address is 4881 Euclid Road, Virginia Beach, Virginia, 23462. And if you need to pause and come back to that at some point and get that address, you can. You can also text give. You can give by opening up the text app on your phone and typing in the numbers 73256 and then typing in the word discovery, send that. And a little word of caution, for those of you who do text give, and this is your first time giving since last Sunday, then you'll notice that there are a couple of things that are different. Don't be alarmed. Realm, you'll see that word pop up and you may question it. That's who we use to receive the funds into the church. But you may have to re-enter all of your information that you had before, but don't worry, it'll be saved from that point forward. And you can always drop a check by us to right here in the office. We've got someone here Monday through Thursday, 9 to 3. And if for some reason that doesn't work out, you just give us a call or email us and we'll arrange some way for you to get it here, or we'll come and get it from you, whatever the case may be. But having said that, all that about offerings and such, we often idolize money and material things, and they can easily become a god to us. And I believe that is a little bit of a challenge for us today, especially since many of us are without jobs, and you don't have an income coming in, and you may be very concerned, if not worried, and maybe even having some sleepless nights over how you're going to pay bills and put food on the table and so on and so forth. And so it may be even a greater challenge at this time right now to focus on money and material things instead of God. And so maybe from that standpoint, this is a very timely message. But it's message 2 in the 10-part series on the 10 commandments. And yes, you guessed it, there are 10 of them. No comments from the peanut gallery here today, but some of you are probably going, boo, hiss. Anyway, and Mother's Day. This has got to be one of the most burdensome Mother's Days that the United States, and maybe the whole world, has experienced in a long, long time. It's not just a day, and it's not just a Sunday. It's the day that we honor mothers. And since families can't get together right now, or at least they're not supposed to get together, Sharon and I have witnessed some families getting together, but this, it might make for the most challenging Mother's Day ever. And so I pray a special blessing on our mothers and families and so on and so forth. Well, not to belabor the point any longer, but message two comes from Exodus chapter 20, verses 4 through 6, and these are the verses for you. You shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything in heaven above, or on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You may have a version that says any graven image. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the sin of the fathers to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. In many places in the Bible, we find people who had seen or been in the presence of angels, and by sheer awe of their holy presence and power and suddenness of their appearance, people would bow down to them out of reverence and fear. But each time, these angels would tell the person to whom they appeared to stand up, for they were not to be worshipped. Now, that is one instance, or one thing about worshiping something that appears to be a deity. But angels are not deity. They're not gods. Several years ago, a friend of mine would ask me, he said, Jay, what do you think about all these other gods that the Romans have and Greeks and so on and so forth? Is it possible that some of them were angels, that they had witnessed them doing something that was supernatural beyond the human ability, and maybe they considered them to be gods? Maybe. I don't know. I wasn't there. And Bob isn't here today for me to pick on him, but
maybe. He's watching.
He is watching. You said he's watching. Hi, Bob. Maybe you can answer that question for us at some point. But Bob just turned 90 a few weeks ago, and I pick on him every now and then. Love you, Bob. That's just one thing that can often grab our attention and take our attention away from God. And that's when these angels would appear to people. They would say, don't worship me. I'm not something to be worshipped. You know, fear God, worship God, and God alone. Well, I've got three things I want to share with you from these three verses. And they're not necessarily revelatory. They're not necessarily anything new. But maybe some of the things that we discuss and or explore or examine as a result of these three points, that might be new. Number one, God is invisible. Did you know that? God, sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. Just bear with me. God is invisible. It comes from verse 4. And verse 4 says, you shall not make for yourself any idol in the form of anything in heaven above or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. Did you know that God is invisible? You knew that, right?
Yeah.
See, I told you this wasn't necessarily anything great, wonderful, or revelatory or new. But the reason I chose that point is because we need to be reminded that according to John 4, 23 and 24, God is spirit. He is spirit. He is invisible. You cannot see him. No one has been allowed to see God. The scripture even says no one can see God and live. Moses was permitted to see God from his back, as Moses was put in the cleft of the rock, and God put his hand over and he passed by. He was allowed to see the back of God. But because God is a spirit, God is invisible. No one, therefore, knows what he looks like. And no human being can, therefore, make, craft, mold, build, or otherwise sculpt an image of God. I hope you see the relevance to that. God is invisible, and you shall have no other, or you shall make no other, you shall make for yourself no idol in the form of anything, in heaven above, earth below, so on and so forth. Sometimes people attempt to make something that represents God. Whatever it is they can visualize in their own minds as God. Any earthen representation of him is impossible. No one can see him. No one has seen him and lived. He is invisible. And so, since no one knows what he looks like, no human being can make, form, mold, craft, graven, any kind of idol or image that accurately represents God. To attempt to do so would be sin. To attempt to make something that looks like God is sin. Not only this, but since God condemns the worship of any other god, lowercase g, that would be sin as well. These other gods could likely be, as I mentioned a moment ago, angels mistaken for their power and beauty, and their appearances over the centuries could be what has motivated many people to revere and worship them for what they can do and how they appear. But the Lord, our God, is clear. He says, mankind is not to make any such thing that is considered to represent him or compete with him. Why? He's the one and only true and living God. He is Yahweh. He is Jehovah. We're going to think about it in just a few minutes. He is the one and only true and living God of the universe, the all-powerful, uncontainable, boundless, limitless God who has skillfully formed you and me and every human being with his own hands, with his own imagination, with his own creative genius by the dust of the earth. Think about that for just a moment. That God, our God, there is no one like our God. He is beyond searching. His ways are beyond our ways. We cannot fathom all that he is and what he does and how that he does. Therefore, we cannot remotely attempt to fashion anything to accurately represent him. And he says, you shall not make for yourself an idol or a graven image or anything that is to become a kind of God. Something that you would maybe bow down to and serve. And then bowing down doesn't mean, oh, thank you, I worship you. It's not necessarily that overt. You think about worship of God. When I think about worship of God, it is worshiping him for who he is. Not for who I am, or not anything in this world. He transcends this world. He made it, but he is far beyond this world and beyond my comprehension. There is no way in my limited understanding I can comprehend who and all and what God is. We know some things about God. We know that he is loving and he is merciful and he is forgiving and he's long-suffering. And he is love, and he is true, and he is pure, and he is holy, and he is just. We know those kinds of things about his character and the attributes of who God is. But even still, we cannot fully comprehend all that he is. And so when he says, you shall not make for yourself any idol in the form of anything in heaven above, that means no angelic being. No deity-looking kind of creature. And remember, angels are created beings. God created them. He made them. He did not make them in his likeness. You and I are uniquely made in the image of God, not angels. The Bible says one day we're going to judge angels. Right now we're made just a little lower, but one day we're going to be elevated to a status above that. Can you just imagine that for a moment? One day the Bible says you and I are going to judge angels. Think about that. Doesn't that make you feel small for just a moment? Right now, in my puny little humanness, in my faulty and flawed and fallen human nature, one day I'm going to be elevated above angels. That's scary to me. Have you thought about that before? It kind of should make you stand up and pay attention a little bit, right? But we're to make no thing that represents anything in the heavens above, no angelic being, as holy as we can even make cherubs appear through art and pictures and sculpture and so on and so forth. And aren't they cute? I mean, aren't cherubs just often really cute? As much as we can make them appear, we're not to elevate them to any kind of status of as a god or deity and bow down and worship them. And you know what? I once knew a lady who collected angels. She had a vast collection of angels, and she was, everywhere she went, she was looking for a new angel. She could tell you all about the different ones, and where she got this one, and where she got that one, and so on and so forth. They all had special meaning in her life. And you kind of have to wonder, if you ever saw the collection of angels that this lady had, you would go, is this your God? Because this is what she thought, and this is what she lived for, collecting angels. And when asked, you know, why do you do this? She says, because I believe in guardian angels. You know, I believe in guardian angels too, but I believe in guardian angels. I believe they're all around us, and they're always protecting us. And yes, they're doing all those kinds of things, but guess who made them? Guess who gave them their jobs to do? Guess who gave them their power? Guess who gave them the message to deliver to you? They don't do anything that God doesn't tell them to do. They are his servants, his messengers. But you could easily make the leap, at least for her, that she really deified angels. Scripture goes on to say, don't make for yourself any idol on the earth that represents anything on the earth beneath. The earth beneath. No animal of the land, no bird of the air, as cuddly even as we can make a teddy bear look or feel. Or, and it might give us some comfort, and you might even feel a little bit of safety or security by having a little cuddly teddy bear, right? You have a favorite teddy bear? You didn't? Sorry, didn't know you would be here. This was prepared a while back. So. But no thing on earth. Does anybody here collect things? Anybody collect things? Do you collect teddy bears for a chance?
No, not teddy bears.
There's something about our human nature that we like to collect things. You know, I like to collect $100 bills, but I don't have very many in my collection. Anybody with me on that? How about you at home? You like to collect $100 bills? As a matter of fact, I don't think I have any. Sharon has them all, but anyway. She has them all because I give them to her, okay? So whatever. Every time I get one, it just goes right to her, right out of my hands into hers. Same thing with the check and whatever. I have an old joke for those of you who haven't heard it. I don't have any money because I'm married. She just went, thigh slapper. Yeah, anyway. Yes, I can get away with that. You can't. But furthermore, all the earth beneath. So no animal, as cuddly as teddy bears might look, or cats or dogs or any of those things. They're not to be, we're not to make anything that represents anything above or beneath. And the Bible says, in the waters below. So no aquatic creature. As cute as we can make dolphins like Flipper look. And they're said to be one of the most intelligent animals of the world, dolphins. Well, moving along. Verse 5, point number 2. God is jealous. Jealous. We have cats at home. We have 4 of them. We have 2 sets of sisters. And they're, what, about 8 years apart? Something like that. Well, if one is getting attention, there's another one that's jealous and going to run up and get in the way to get some attention. Austin's shaking his head. It's just the way it is, right? It might be the same way with dogs. I don't have any dogs, but Cats are very much that way. You know, people are that way too. You may have someone, especially, we got the young people sitting on this side of the room today, so. Happy Mother's Day to y'all, by the way.
I'm the youngest on this side.
Oh, excuse me.
Oh, wow. For those of you who are not here, the bus just came through and ran right over this side. True as it may be. Anyway, remember when you were young and you're dating someone and or you wanted to date someone that someone else was dating? You might have been jealous of that person. Jealousy isn't always a good thing, humanly speaking. But let's look at this a little more closely. Well, as mentioned in verse 3 last week, for those of you who weren't here, God said, "You shall have no other gods before me." In the Hebrew, the word before means what? Does anybody remember? It means to be in conflict with or to be in front of. Apply this to the second commandment of not having an idol for yourself. Any other god that man makes or reveres or bows to or idolizes is in direct conflict with Jehovah God and stirs his jealousy. But this is not the kind of jealousy that you and I might think of as, oh, I wish I had that, or I wish he was my boyfriend or she was my girlfriend or something like that, or I wish this, or I got a cat that's getting some attention and my little one wants to get in the way. Wants to get before, wants to be in direct conflict with. It's the same kind of thing, but it's different this way. God, this jealousy that God has is born out of his inexhaustible love for us. God has chosen Israel, his peculiar people, and set them apart from all other peoples of the world to be the recipients of his covenant blessing and care. And if you remember from last week, this whole Ten Commandments, these 10 words, as it reads in Hebrew, are God's outlining of his stipulations for his people to live in his covenant blessing and care because of what he has done for them. He delivered them from their bondage and slavery in Egypt. And as a result of that, in Near Eastern kind of a treaty fashion, God says, here's the preamble. I am the Lord your God. And guess what? And God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God who brought you out of, his declaration, who brought you out of. Remember this historical proclamation that he made. Remember what I have done for you. You were in bondage and slavery for hundreds of years. But I brought you out of that. And I delivered you in a mighty and miraculous kind of way. Don't forget that. And oh, by the way, these are 10 things I want you to live by. He says, number one, you shall have no other gods before me. I'm first and foremost in your life. Number two, you shall have no idol. You shall not make for yourself anything that represents something in the heavens above, the earth beneath, or the waters below. There's to be nothing in between you and me. And this jealousy that God has, it comes out of his inexhaustible love. His love that can never be extinguished, never goes out. God has chosen Israel to be his chosen people, or his peculiar people, and set them apart from every other people group in the world to be his specific recipients of his blessing and care. This demands that his people love him and him alone. This kind of jealousy. To spurn his love is a terrible sin against him, and he will not abide this form of dishonor. God's love for his people demands their exclusive devotion to him and his commands. The Hebrew word for jealous, you're probably wondering what this is. It's the same word, the Hebrew word for jealous is the same word in Hebrew for zeal. Z-E-A-L. It's the same word in Hebrew. But in English, it has two different meanings. Jealous is, oh, I'm jealous, I wish I had. Zeal is passion. I'm passionate about this. I'm very passionate about putting this in context, God says, I am very passionate about my people whom I rescued from their slavery. And because I am very passionate about them, love them so much, so dearly, you shall have no other gods before me, and you shall not attempt to make any other thing that represents a god. There's to be nothing in between us. And his passion out of his love is what bears this out. And it often comes down to context and how the word is used, whether it is jealous or zeal. It would be very easy to substitute the word zeal here for jealous. When God says, I am a jealous God, I am a zealous God. I'm a passionate, loving God. Because his love for us is zealous. It is passionate toward us in such a way that his fullness, the fullness of his love, is directed to us and demonstrated. Think about this for a second. The passion that God has for us, this zeal that he has for us, he put it on full display. He showed the entire world how much he loves you and me. How did he put that on full display? He hung his son on a cross and had him crucified for you and me. That is the demonstration of God's love. That he would give up, that he would sacrifice his only begotten son, his only birthed son into this world for you and me. And so his passion is what drove him to do that. His love for us is what motivated him to demonstrate his passion, his zealousness, his jealousness. God says that he will punish those who reject him and worship other things. Now, I know that sounds harsh. As we talked about last week, some of these things are going to sound a little harsh. But hopefully by the time this series ends, we'll have a deeper understanding and a deeper meaning of what God is trying to tell his people then and tell us now. He says that he would punish those who reject him and worship other things or other gods. Even saying that he will do so to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me. That's what the verse says. To the third and fourth generation. Does that sound fair? Does it sound fair that you and I could be suffering for something that our forefathers did three or four generations ago? That doesn't sound fair, does it? Some believe that literally and some not so much. There are many theories from many different angles on what exactly this means, and some people discount the fact that God would exact punishment on one generation for what a previous generation has done. It doesn't seem fair. But remember this, God made us all. He owns us all. Take a look at a couple of examples from the Bible. In Numbers 16, 31 through 34, Korah, Dathan, and Abiram rose up against Moses and Aaron. They wanted to be the priests of Israel. And look at what happened. As soon as Moses finished saying all this, the ground under them split apart, and the earth opened its mouth and swallowed them with their households and all Korah's men and all their possessions. Here's what happened. These three men, Korah, Dathan, and Abiram, they challenged Moses and Moses' brother Aaron, who was the priest of Israel. And they said, we want to be the priests. Granted, these are Levites. God has already given them a special place within the nation of Israel. And Moses says to them, hey, isn't that enough for you? Now you want to be in charge of all the priesthood duties and so on and so forth? And God went to the Lord and had a conversation, and God impressed upon him to tell these three men this. Going to come out tomorrow. There's going to be a test, basically. And the Lord will choose if it's you or if it's Aaron. And Moses said to them, this is what the Lord will do. He will open up the ground, swallow you, you and your whole households, and all of your men. Now, this is the night before. The next day, they get up, and Moses has them stand out at the opening to their tents. And they were very disrespectful to Moses. You can read more of Numbers chapter 16. And you know something? Exactly as Moses had said would happen the night before, happened. They come out of the tents. The ground right there opened up, says the mouth of the earth opened up and swallowed them and all of their households. The word household is very important. Translated from the Hebrew, it means third and fourth generations. You know why? It's often very common for multiple generations to live in the same home. It's not so common here in America. Your kids grow up and you can't wait to get them out. And it's been said the reason you didn't kill your children is because of your grandchildren. Are you right? Anyway, I digress. The point is this. These men rose up against Moses and Aaron. They challenged them. They wanted to be the priests of the nation of Israel. And God swallowed them and their households. You see, these three men, they sinned against the Lord. And as a punishment for their sin, their whole households suffered right along with them. If you need another example, in Joshua chapter 7, the sin of Achan. You remember what happened with Achan? He kept some of the spoils of war, and he hid it in his tent, trying to hide it from the Lord. Can you imagine that? The God who sees all things, he's trying to hide it from the Lord. And God tells Joshua, hey, go and cast lots, and the lots fell to Achan, and said, hey, go get him and ask him what's going on. And he fessed up, and he said, yep, I took some of the stuff. And you know what happened? Joshua and the leaders got Achan and his family, and they took him out and they did what to him? You remember? They stoned them to death. And the Bible says in Joshua chapter 24 and 25 that after they were stoned to death, they were burned. I know that sounds terrible. You see, Achan stole the spoils of war. He tried to hide it from everyone, including the Lord. But when it was found out that he had done this thing, that he had sinned against the Lord, because it was the Lord who said, don't take any of the spoils of the war, leave it. Achan, along with his sons and his daughters and everything they owned, the people were stoned to death and all their possessions were burned so that there was no trace of them. See, God is a jealous God who passionately loves his people and desires that we live in his covenant blessing by living according to his commandments. The God who is Father of all, who is above all, who is through all, and who is in all, Ephesians 4, 6, will have no one else between us and him. I know you might be saying, well, how can I live that way? Ask God to help you with that. Put him first. Maybe start your day with him and have him order your steps, as the word says, and see how you might put him first. See how it is that he might impress you and lead you to put him first. Third thing, God is loving. Did you know that about God? See, I told you none of these are necessarily earth-shattering. But God is a loving God. Verse 6. But showing love to a thousand generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. So did I mention that God loves us? Did I mention that God loves you, every last one of you? God loves you. God loves you too, listening on Facebook Live this morning. God is a jealous God, but God is a loving God. He loves us, but he loves us passionately, zealously, and fervently. And those upon whom he has lavished his love, he expects our response to be one of total allegiance and trust expressed in our faithful obedience. And I know we don't like the words obey or obedience in this time and this country and so on and so forth, but it's really important that we obey the word of the Lord. It is important that we obey and live by his commands. Those who love God in perpetuity, showing love to 1,000 generations. That sounds perpetual to me. Those who love God in perpetuity, those who seek him and his will from generation to generation, will be the recipients of his compassion, love, and care, and abiding presence, and his inexhaustible protection and provision. Amen? But those who are disobedient, elsewhere in the Bible called them the wicked, or the unsaved, those who continue to reject God and reject Jesus, they forfeit God's care and compassion and love. That doesn't mean he doesn't love you now. He does, and he wants you to come to the saving knowledge of his son, Jesus Christ. God is not slack, but he is long-suffering, wanting none to perish, but all to come to the knowledge of his son, Jesus Christ, and to repent of their sin. His word tells us that. But there's going to come a time when this life ends. And when this life ends, so does the opportunity to repent of sin and confess Jesus as Savior. You don't want to wait until that point. And if you're here today, you don't want to wait until that point. Because if you wait until life is over, you've waited too long. There is no second chance. You either accept Jesus as your Savior and Lord in this life, or you don't. And that is sad. God has shown you, and shown me, and showed all of us how much he loves us, how much he cares for us, and how much it is that he wants you to know his son Jesus and to receive the life that is truly life the Apostle Paul wrote about. Would you confess your sin right now and ask Jesus to save you, rescue you for all eternity? Because all who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I can't promise you your life will necessarily get better in terms of circumstances, because we're all reaping what we sow. I can promise you your outlook on this life will dramatically improve, and you will have the peace of knowing that you have eternal life in Christ Jesus. He promised it, and he always keeps his promises. Well, did you ever think that there was this much to the Ten Commandments? We've only looked at two of them. They are much more than words etched on stone tablets or printed in the pages of a leather-bound book. God is serious about his love for us, and he wants us to be as serious about following his ways. And you know, it's for our good, not our harm, that we live for him. What about you? Do you idolize anything? Is there anything between you and God? Or is God first and foremost in your life? You know that, and he knows that. But if there's anything that is in between the two of you, would you ask God to help you get it out of the way once and for all, and put him first? Dedicate yourself to living for him, and see what it is that he does in your life, and see how he works things out in ways you never thought possible. I'm convinced that according to the truth of his word, and as much as I have experienced in my life, if you would trust God, you would find that he is trustworthy. And he has your best at heart, now and forevermore. Would you ask him to help you cast down every idol and make him the Lord of your life? Let's pray together. Heavenly Father, thank you that you've given us your word and you've spoken to us. I pray in a timely fashion and shown us where it is that we have difficulty putting you first. We have a variety of things that vie for our attention and easily distract us from putting you first. Today, God, help us to commit ourselves to you, to dedicate our lives to you, putting you first and trusting you to work out all the details, knowing that you want and you have our best at heart. And it is first in your life toward us. God bless us and even continue to bless us now and forevermore. But as we sing now an uplifting song, a song of praise and of jubilation, as we close together today, we thank you for allowing us to be in your house and for us to be able to gather in our homes to worship you. Continue to have your will and way in us and through us, God, as we sing together, Days of Elijah. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.
Righteousness be.
y'all for tuning in. Have a great week. Again, we'll let you know about the details concerning the 50% capacity once we know what they are. Until then, bye for now.